Good evening. I'm Susan Shelly McGovern. I'll be your host tonight for Centering on Peace. I am a member of the Berks Peace Community. Tonight we are talking about the topic of mass incarceration and some issues related to that topic. All of my guests tonight are associated with the New Person Ministries, which is a local faith-based organization that works to help men find housing, work, and hope after release from prison. So we're doing things a little differently tonight. For the first part of the show, our guests will be the Reverend John Rush, who is on the end here. John has a long history of advocacy for those in prison and those reentering society, and is the former executive director of New Person Ministries. In the center, we have James Young, who is a case manager for New Person Ministries and also is active in addressing justice issues with the NAACP. Next to me here is Jordan Kauffman, a Lancaster County resident who currently serves as executive director of New Person Ministries. So they can tell you more about their roles within the organization as we talk. For the second half of the program, Patty Antosy and Gordon Diem will join John Rush and myself. Pat is the administrative assistant at New Person, and Gordon serves as outreach coordinator. All of them are extremely knowledgeable about how the prison system works and the problems associated with imprisonment and reentry into society. As you probably know, these topics have been getting a lot of attention lately, both at the local and national levels. Reading's mayor and some local legislators have been addressing the ban the box issue, which may make it easier for people with a criminal history to secure work. Guest James Young has been involved with that initiative, and he can talk about that. And President Obama recently gave a much publicized talk about mass incarceration and the need to change the way we do prison in America. So before we get started, I just want to remind you that this is a call-in show. You're welcome to share your thoughts or questions. The number is on the screen, 610-378-0426. So I'd like to start by asking John Rush, who has been working with those who are incarcerated since 1966, to share his perspectives on imprisonment in America and some of the issues associated with it.
Thank you, Susan, for having us on the program tonight.
Well, thank you for being here.
One of the issues that we need to talk about is whether we just want to be tough on responding to crime or be smart. And it's possible to be both, I believe, but sometimes we're tough and we focus on retaliation instead of being smart in terms of the greatest benefits and outcomes in the long run. For example, here in Pennsylvania, there's about, out of the 51,000 men and women in our state prisons, of which there are 27, not to count those coming out of federal prisons and county prisons across our state, but just in our state prisons alone, they are exiting about 16,000 men and women every year coming out of those gates back into our neighborhoods. So if we're smart about crime, we will be paying attention to those people that are in there today, because tomorrow most of them are going to be our neighbors again. We're told that about 95% of everybody that goes into the state system is coming out again. So the whole notion of putting your head in the sand like an ostrich and saying, we locked them up, now we're safe, that's a huge myth that's dangerous, and that's a bad thing. I believe it's possible to be sensitive about victims' issues, which of course everybody wants to be. At the same time, think restorative when it comes to offenders. What's going to restore them back to work, back to their families, back to parenting, back to being positive, productive citizens. And of course, everybody wants community safety. I want to feel safe in my neighborhood. I want my grandchildren to feel safe. Everybody naturally cares about that. But if we're smart on crime, I would say, then our communities will be safer. Just being tough on crime will not make our communities safer. Some people try to say that if we make more laws and get tougher on crime, we're going to be safer. That absolutely is not true. You know, I would argue against that idea.
Can we just talk a little bit about the history of the tough on crime thought process and how that has, over the past 30 or 40 years, really resulted in this skyrocketing rate of imprisonment.
Well, the other two can comment on that, but I'll just say this. I think that a lot of things in life are like a pendulum. In the early 70s, there may have been an emphasis on rehabilitation, and then there were some real horrendous crimes that happened, and people's fury, you know, came to the boiling point, and then they legislate real tough new laws, and sentencing guidelines are maximized, and then you have prisons being built. There for a while, we were building a new prison here in Pennsylvania every year. We went from like 8 prisons in the early 80s to 27 state prisons. I'm not talking again about jails and federal prisons. So I don't know, Jim, Jordan, what comments you have on that?
Basically, I think the biggest thing was back in mid-90s is when it was a major thing to, they went back, reevaluated the laws based on different situations that came up, increased the mandatory minimums, mm-hmm. lengthened the minimum sentences in many, or maximum sentences in many cases, and made it harder to make parole. They created a lot of situations just as a knee-jerk reaction to situations and for the legislators to look good.
Yeah, because there's a lot of pressure on mm-hmm. legislators mm-hmm. to be, I mean, like we've mm-hmm. talked about this, like no legislator wants to be accused of being soft on crime.
Mm-hmm. I think if you look back too, the major focus prior to 96 as far as parole was to reintegrate the offender back into society. After post 96, public safety was a focal point, which nothing wrong with that. Public safety should be a major factor. However, without a successful reintegration back into society, the ex-offender, you know, if he can't find work, he can't get help for various things, he winds up recidivating, committing new crimes, and goes back. So it just keeps building the taxpayer's bill.
And I'd also say there's also a history of racism within the prison system as well. Not necessarily those who are working in it, but with politicians who are making the laws. And you can look at them now and say, well, no, they're all equal and fair, the laws we have. And without debating that, it's almost it's like if you're playing Monopoly and someone's been cheating for 6 rounds, yeah. and then they say, okay, now we're going to start over, but they never give the money back that they started with. You know, you're going to see issues arise, and you're going to see disproportionately. Amount of minorities in prison as opposed to whites.
Right.
But I think if you look at that too, the Sentencing Project put out some interesting statistics on that where, as far as males go, 1 in 9 men are in prison. Of that, 1 in 17 white men, 1 in 3 black men are in prison, and 1 in 6 Latinos.
1 in 3?
Yes.
African Americans? Yes. I don't know if I ever heard that. It's high of
yes.
1 in 3.
And that was from, like I said, the Sentencing Project, 2014. So it's recent.
And for the most part, you're talking about African-American men between the age of, say, 18 and 30. So you're impacting communities, those communities in particular, in a huge way in terms of the impact on the next generation and means to make a living and all of that. We talk sometimes about the pipeline school to prison. In some communities in this nation, and that's something that we really need to improve upon.
But I think too, a couple things here: black males in their 30s, 1 in every 10 is in prison or jail. So that's significant. But then too, if you look at that, most of the minorities are centered in the center cities, be it Reading, Philadelphia, Pittsburgh, whomever. They build the prisons in the rural areas. So what happens is when the census is taken, most recently the 2010 one, those monies, when they take that, they come up with, you know, the demographics for that area. Mm-hmm. Then what happens is the distribution of welfare dollars, education dollars, what have you, goes back to the rural areas because the prisoners are counted in that particular area. They're no longer in Center City. So, like we use Reading for an example, they lose all those tax dollars. And it's shifted out to the middle of nowhere. So
a good illustration of that in Pennsylvania would be Forest County. For example, the prison population is about equal to the county population.
Really?
Because of the large state prison near Marionville.
And they actually give, I think, Forest is the largest growing county population-wise in the state because the prison out there is new. just depending on how you count populations.
Wow.
Here in Pennsylvania, Susan, one of the most outstanding innovators in the criminal justice system, in my opinion, is Stuart Greenleaf, who is chair of the Senate Judiciary Committee. And he was quoted by a local reporter here of the Reading Eagle, Nicole Brambilliam. In the Eagle, June 24, again, I'm quoting Senator Stuart Greenleaf, quote, "I've always said punishment without rehabilitation is a failure." And that's important to grab that, the meaning of that.
I'm sure.
Yeah.
I think we were going to talk about like what's happening in the state. Are these issues being addressed in Pennsylvania?
Yeah, I mean, we'll ban the boxes one, which I'm sure mm-hmm. Jim will talk about. As I said earlier, a lot of the kind of the issues aren't necessary with the people who are working within the judicial system. I think whether it's corrections officers or Secretary Wetzel within the Department of Probation and Parole, I think everyone's pretty aware of the problems that are going on. It's how do you get larger society to kind of understand that? Because you can't, again, as was said earlier, you can't win an election if you look soft on crime. And so there's a lot of conversations going on. One thing that is happening in October, the 23rd through 25th in Harrisburg, the Pennsylvania Council of Churches is having a conference on mass incarceration, which registration's open for that at pachurches.org. But just kind of, just trying to bring people in, bring speakers in to kind of shed light and do a lot of education.
So is it an education issue?
I'd say that's part of it, yeah. It's part of it's education for society at large to know kind of what is really going on. And then also part of it is having leaders who kind of have the courage to step up and say there is a problem there. I know Senator Greenleaf's one. Mm-hmm. Even Secretary Wetzel has been very outspoken, saying as much as, you know, why are we calling a correction system if we don't actually do any correcting?
And Secretary Wetzel, Secretary of the Department of Corrections in
correct.
Pennsylvania.
Yes.
Yeah. And he was a guard, a correctional officer at Berks County Prison for a time. So we're very proud of his leadership.
And
it's very innovative. It's good leadership.
He hasn't been secretary for too long, a couple years?
Yeah, 5 years probably, 4 or 5 years. He was on the Pardons Board prior to that, and then a warden at Franklin County, and a correctional officer at Berks and Lebanon prior to that. Great history.
And Governor Wolf kept him on as well when he was elected.
Yeah, good choice.
And has he been able to make a difference so far?
He is. I would encourage people on TED Talk to look up John Wetzel. He has some really inspiring speeches.
Oh,
makes you think about criminal justice.
And I think they said, I don't want to quote misinformation, but I think in 2014 was the first time the state prison population actually declined for the first time in it was over a decade, I want to say at least 15 years.
In some states, like I believe it's true in Delaware, but it's certainly true in New York, in the last 6 years they've actually closed a couple prisons because of taking a smarter on crime and taking more of a restorative approach, not to just lock everybody up. That's not the answer in an intelligent society. So I think things are improving. It's encouraging to me to see some of these initiatives taking place from the top down finally. The Pope, by the way, when he comes, Pope Francis in 2 weeks, he's going to be visiting the Women's Correctional Institution in Philadelphia at Riverside, and he's also going to be speaking to Congress. And there are groups that are optimistic that he's going to include the importance of prison reform here in Pennsylvania in that speech to Congress.
And
very encouraging.
Whether Congress will heed the Pope's speech or not remains to be seen, of course, but it'll be interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I also hope he talks about climate change, but that's a topic for another
And
night.
If they don't listen to the Pope, maybe they'll listen to Jesus Christ, who said he cares about people in prison. That would be a good step in the right direction.
So what happens in our society? I mean, somebody gets sent off to prison. Does the person's family have no voice? It seems like, you know, someone goes off to prison and largely is forgotten, not forgotten, but ignored. Mm-hmm.
It can be, because it depends where the inmate winds up being located. Mm-hmm. And right now they're locating them due to bed space. I know Secretary Wessel's trying to locate them back closer to their home area.
Especially toward the end.
When it gets close to their minimum and so forth. However, you know, it's difficult for people to, you know, go out and do visits. If they're, you know, they're in Philly, they're in the western part of the state, that's very difficult.
Right.
Although the PA Prison Society does have what they call virtual visits, but not all the institutions have those.
And they also have buses, hundreds and hundreds of trips per year across the state to help families in the Philly area especially. A lot of the inmate population in the state is out of Philly. So they do provide a lot of bus transportation to the distant places, like all the way up at Erie and mid-state. And,
because you figure for Philadelphia, they generate about 30% plus.
Because people who live in Philadelphia may not even have a car to be able to drive someplace.
That's true.
Yeah. And especially for the women. The women's main prison is all the way up at Muncie, which is Williamsport. That's for children to be brought to visit their mothers. That's a several-hour drive, and then sometimes you may wait an hour to get in or two. I mean, it's a big ordeal to keep the bonding in contact with the children with their parents.
Yeah.
And then the other women's prison is Cambridge Springs, all the way out near Erie. So, you know, that's one reason why they're trying to establish a women's prison within the walls of Greaterford, because of that Philadelphia mothers and children issue.
Right. Yeah. I just heard of a program in Berks County where master gardeners work with women from Berks County Prison, and they say it's the master gardeners used to go to the prison, but now the women can come to maybe the ag center or a neutral location and work with the master gardeners.
What, do they have lead ball and chain on their ankle? That cultivates the ground, that pulls the weeds out. I can understand that.
Okay, we have a home viewer on the line, so we're going to take just a minute here.
Okay.
Hello.
Yes.
And thanks for calling.
Sure.
Did you have a question?
Yes, I do.
All right, go ahead.
Yes. My question is, I'm concerned about corporations using prisoners to increase their profits. The prisoners are making pennies on in a day, getting paid very little, and I believe the corporations would probably have a lot of influence over the legislators. So the motivation to close these prisons is probably less. Can any of the guests speak to this issue?
At least a little bit. I mean, I know there are private prisons which are, even within Pennsylvania, I don't know if we have any private prisons in Pennsylvania.
Yes, a federal.
We have one federal. But with a private prison, it is a corporation who runs it, and they do have stockholders. So for them to actually, I'd say, rehabilitate well would almost be against their self-interest. Because if you rehabilitate well and the prison population declines, well then, I mean, there goes your money. And I've actually seen some of the literature for some of these private prisons that they give to stockholders, and they quote a high recidivism rate as a reason to invest in their private prisons. Mm-hmm. And then, Jim, you can probably talk about within kind of state prisons here as well, kind of how that plays out.
Well, I mean, fortunately, there's no private state prisons, which is a good thing, because medical care and everything else seems to deteriorate with the private prisons. From everything that's been published out there.
We did have a private prison in Delaware County here, down near Media, a number of years back. And one of the problems was you had the top administrators getting a real high salary because they were like retired in the field of corrections nationally and got hired. But then the correctional officers down at the bottom of the totem pole got a low wage. So you had a high turnover and a poor work quality relationship with the residents. And that was I didn't think too good. Wasn't good, but it's not that way anymore.
Yeah. Did that answer your question? Is the home viewer still on? Okay. Well, thank you for your call, and I hope that that answered your question. So we were talking about, did you say everything, Jim, that you wanted to about the racial disparities?
Well, basically, we had already talked about that originally, but one thing, too, when John was bringing up about the women, Sentencing Project brought something up which kind of surprised me a little bit. Two-thirds of the women in prison do have minor children. So that's, you know, a significant piece of the puzzle there. Trying to keep that mother-child bonding there is difficult.
Yes, I'm sure it
would
be.
But it is essential for the families, and that's one thing that does happen quite often is for those who are incarcerated, they do lose contact with family, friends, especially if they're serving a lengthy sentence.
One of the good things here locally in Berks is the program where mothers can read to their children from prison. Althea Harmon and the Berks Connections group has organized that. That's been a good program for many years now, probably close to two decades. Mm-hmm. So there are things you can do like that while during the punishment stage, they're still not forgetting the children and their needs. So that's good.
And this, again, as far as the racial disparities, if you read The New Jim Crow by Michelle Alexander, she goes into much more detail than I think all the knowledge of us.
Oh, yeah, you know, definitely. Yeah.
So, again, I would encourage people to look up TED Talk and
put
her name in, a very powerful speech of about 30 minutes.
But, you know, I think a big thing with this, though, too, is when people return to, you know, they come out, they return to their areas. Employment, housing are very difficult to find. Employment, and that's one reason why we tried to focus on Ban the Box around here. Because there's quite a few people that come back to this area. But now Philadelphia's had it for several years. Pittsburgh, Allegheny County has also had it. Now Reading, we were the fourth city to do something back on March 8th when Mayor Spencer announced that we were going to do a city employment, which is good. And Allentown has done it. Now, it seems like everybody else is waiting for the state legislature to do something. And there's been some talk, but until they pass the budget, nothing's going to happen there. And that's, I kind of wonder if that'll happen. If they can't pass the budget, how are they going to pass this?
Yeah.
Susan, maybe Jordan could give the website an email for New Person Ministries. And if people would email and ask for the link for that talk by John Wetzel, Secretary Wetzel of the Department of Corrections, or Michelle Alexander, mm-hmm. we could send them the link. Mm-hmm. They could watch those speeches. They're very educational.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that would be great.
Could you do it, Jordan?
Yeah, our website is newpersonministries.org. Our email address is on there. Any other questions as well, whether it's about kind of the stuff we've mentioned or just general questions. We're happy to answer them, you know, the best we can.
And next week we're taking $1,000 donations once and done. So,
I will say we do have our banquet coming up, which is our fundraising banquet, which I'll just plug quickly on September 25th. But information can be found online for that as well.
So. Okay. So do you think that President Obama's talk, which was very well publicized and has been debated, do you think that will lead to more conversation as a country about these issues?
I mean, and there was ongoing talk before he made those visits. I believe it's the Colson Commission, named after Chuck Colson, the founder of Prison Fellowship International. There's a group of politicians, people from organizations who are addressing the issues of mass incarceration and reentry as well. I know Senator Rand Paul and Senator Cory Booker, so you have a Republican and a Democrat. I know they've introduced some legislation that they've tried to push through as well, just kind of working with all of this. So, yeah, I think things are moving slowly, but, yeah.
One thing people could Google if you want more information about what's going on in Congress with this is look up Second Chance Reauthorization Act. Just Google that. Second Chance Reauthorization Act. That'll give you a lot of information in response to that question.
But, you know, just to get back to Ban the Box for a second, if you put these put ex-offenders to work, you're going to increase their self-esteem. They're going to be able to pay back the victim's compensation aspect, which will help the victim out. It's going to get the people, hopefully, off the social service rolls, thereby, you know, increasing the tax base for the locale. So these little things, just it all adds up, but there again, it is a lengthy process. I know our city council here does not want to do anything until the state legislature acts, because they don't want to offend anybody. But I'm just going to take a minute and just say, look, I think somebody really needs to step up to the plate and do something here. Because Philadelphia's done it. There's no reason Reading can't do it, except they're too concerned about offending people. You're politicians, you offend a lot of people. I think what you really need to do is step up to the plate and do something.
Yeah, a friend of mine just posted on Facebook last week, does anyone know anyone who could help with this? And I actually gave him a few names. He said he had met a, I think he's 27 now or 28, year-old man who had had been in trouble when he was 18 and had served some time in prison and is desperately looking for work and hasn't been able to find it. So hopefully my friend can direct him to...
So 2 months ago, this was a headline in the Reading Eagle. 1 in 4 Pennsylvanians has a record. That's 1/4 of the state's population. Is this an issue that's relevant? Should we care about it? We had better.
What does that mean, has a record?
Some kind of a criminal justice record.
Has been
prison record.
In...
It's a big deal. I mean, it matters how we treat our neighbors, including those 1 in 4 that have some kind of a criminal record.
Yes.
That matters big time. And I would say the politicians that don't care about 25% of those that they're supposed to represent should not be in office.
Yes. Well, and included among that population are some politicians.
Of course.
That 1 in 4. So. Yeah, it just seems to be common sense, you know, that when people are productive and working, it's better than when they're not. And like some you pointed out, Jim, then are able to contribute to society and
that's what a good many of them want to do. They want to rebuild their lives. So if you can't get a job, you can't get housing, it just snowballs.
For example, the Reading Eagle did a write-up on sex offenders in Berks County. And at that time, there were close to 600 registered sex offenders in Berks County when the article was done, and it said that the majority of them were not able to find work. Why not? Most of them wanted to work, but employers wouldn't hire them. Mm-hmm. That's a recipe for trouble. And it works against community safety. But everybody with felonies, especially of any type, finds that.
Okay, we've got another home viewer on the line. Thank you for calling, and go ahead, please.
Yes, you're emphasizing the release of prisoners and giving them jobs outside of prison when they could do just as well in prison and have jobs there, as far as like cleaning the roads, whatever happened to the chain gangs. You know, and keep them in a punished state. I mean, they would be much better in prison, doing jobs in prison, like the road gangs and everything. There's not enough jobs for, you know, regular people out there. What makes you think you're going to find jobs for released prisoners?
You know, I think it also goes back to Congress and the state legislature to keep jobs here at home as well, because the state legislature, they have a responsibility to try to attract business here. That's going to increase the state's tax base. It's going to do a lot of good things, create jobs, so forth. I would go back there again. It seems like everything goes back to the politicians, and they really need to do more to help their constituents and not just the select few that make the large contributions.
Well, can I, a home viewer, are you still on the line?
Yes.
Are you suggesting that everyone who goes to prison should be kept in prison indefinitely and made to work?
No. I'm saying that, you know, you're talking about the prisoners finding jobs for prisoners once they're released. And like I said, there's not enough jobs even for people out there to find jobs. And what about those jobs like people don't want? Whatever happened to the chain gang jobs, the working on the roads, cleaning up the roads, They can do that when they're in prison. You don't have to wait for them to be released. Those are jobs that other people wouldn't want to take. You're punishing the prisoner. You're keeping them in prison, and they're working, and they can pay off. Those are jobs that people don't want on the outside. Whatever happened to those, like the chain gang, the people that did road work and, cleaned up the streets. I understand they have prisoners that clean up the streets of Reading. Why isn't that being done now?
Does anyone have a
I'll only make this comment. You might remember several years ago, there was a group of inmates from Berks County Prison working along the so-called Road to Nowhere. And one inmate got hit and killed. Those kind of incidences do happen, and there are major liabilities. I just heard on the news tonight that
there's major liabilities with everything else.
Well, that's
correct. And that's an excuse that comes up all the time. It's a major liability, with everything. That's an excuse.
I think the DID program in Reading was a very excellent idea, and I would hope it's still happening. I think Charles Broad supervised it, but I hope it's still happening. But I know for some years they did a lot of cleanup downtown Reading, and it's a great program.
The Downtown Improvement District.
Is that what it is?
Mm-hmm. Yes. It's still operating.
And I think Pat will probably be talking about it later, but, I mean, the cost of incarceration is high as well. Right. So you can say, it'd be good for these guys to be working and doing the jobs while they're in prison, but to house them is incredibly expensive, and that's something taxpayers have mm-hmm. to pay. And it's not also that, the inmates themselves, they're not making anything. I mean, mm-hmm. they're getting paid, pennies on the dollar. Mm-hmm. So yes, they're working and they're doing jobs that other people don't want, but the taxpayer is paying to keep them being housed while they're doing that.
Commissioner Barnhart said 1 year ago in June at a meeting that I was at here in Reading that 70% of our local taxes are used for the correction system. That's the court system, the sheriff's department, the police, the prison system, what have you. That's more than two-thirds of our local real estate taxes. That's a big deal. So we can do better, I believe. We can be smarter in responding to crime.
Well, thank you for your call.
We
are going to take a short break here while we bring in some other guests. We're going to say goodbye to Jim and to Jordan. Thank you very much for
being here.
Thank you for having us. And we'll bring Gordon and Pat on.
Quality television is expensive to produce. BCTV produces over 20 hours a week of live television. We also record on location in our community. With a small staff of 7 and community volunteers, we bring you information on health, the economy, government, the arts, sports, and much more. Community dialogue is our mission and our passion. If the information that our programming provides has benefited you, please give your support to BCTV now. Simply go on our website and click the Donate Now button, call us, or send us a check. Your support will keep BCTV alive.
Making a donation to BCTV is easy. Simply go to bctv.org and click the Support BCTV Donate Now button. It will take you to a form where you can enter your information, safe and secure. You can also mail us a check. If you have any questions, feel free to call us or email us. Why not consider becoming a member? Members receive a variety of great perks. Under About Us, click the Be a Member link. Help us continue to keep bringing you the programs and information you enjoy, on TV and on the web. Your support will keep BCTV alive. Love to shop at Amazon.com? Amazon Smile is the same Amazon you know, except you can support BCTV by using it. You'll find the exact same prices, vast selection, and convenient shopping experience. You can use your existing Amazon.com account, your shopping cart, wish lists, registries, and all other account information stay the same. Simply type in smile.amazon.com and select Berks Community Television as your favorite charitable organization. Then every time you use smile.amazon.com, a portion of every purchase you make will be donated to BCTV. Use a bookmark to get to smile.amazon.com to ensure that BCTV gets your donation. The simple, fun, smart way to shop.
Hi, and welcome back to Centering on Peace. I'm Susan Shelly McGovern. At the far end of the table is John Rush, who was with us for the first part of the show. To my immediate left is Pat Antosy and Gordon Diem from the New Person Ministries. We, right before the break, were talking with a home viewer about the cost of incarceration. And I'd like to continue on that topic for a little bit. And Pat, I think you are well-versed on that.
Well, well-versed as far as New Person Center goes. One of the numbers you can throw out there is $35,000 a year to incarcerate a person in state prisons right now.
More than my kid's college.
Mm-hmm. There you go. Yeah, and that's a good point that you're bringing up here, because we're only we're spending $10,000 a year on a student to go for
public,
the regular
public education.
So it seems to be pretty backwards. Yeah, I often said, you know, we could solve a lot of these problems in my wife's kindergarten class, you know, if we would reverse that, you know, and put it on the front end instead of on the back end.
Does Pennsylvania spend more on corrections than education?
I don't know what that number would be, but yeah, it's right now we're talking about a $2 billion that's being spent in the state, just for the state, you know. And just what you said about your kids, you know, this budget crunch has actually been a benefit because people are finally asking, why am I paying for my kids' art? Why am I paying for my kids' music? Why am I paying for all my kids' extracurriculars? Why am I paying for my kids' sports? They're finally standing up and asking the right question. Where's the money? Where's it going?
Here in Berks County, it's $35 million per year of our tax money going into local corrections, $35 million.
Mm-hmm. That's 70%. Of a county budget. That's unbelievable.
Yeah.
Which could be used for so many other good things if somehow
yeah,
that could be trimmed down.
Yeah, and our taxes keep going up and up.
And the other issue, Susan, on that is too, John quoted 51,000, and we see some stats that half those people in prison, in state prison, are nonviolent. And you gotta ask, what the heck are they doing in there? You know? I mean, they're going in there, they're coming out more violent than when they went in.
There would be other forms of punishment.
Yeah, there's so many other ways. I mean, there's community service.
Probation, parole.
I had a family member who he had to do nights in jail, but he kept on working, kept
his
job,
family,
he kept his house, he kept his family going, he kept everything going. You know, you throw someone in prison, well, guess what? You know, it's not just the one person.
Yeah, exactly. Well, here's the story John and I have talked about. I did an article for the Reading paper about prison visitors. And somebody said to me, oh, if you're going to write an article about prison visitors, you need to talk to John Rush. That's how I met John years ago. So I went to the prison with John and Steve L. Marzucchi, also a prison visitor. And I was talking to the guard while they were getting their pictures taken. I'm like, so, well, what are most people, because obviously we were on a, you know, one of the least secure parts. I said, what are most of the people in this section here for? He said, oh, you know, parking tickets, they didn't pay their child support, which begs the obvious question of, well, now we're paying $35,000 a year to have them sit here.
It would be more like $18,000 at the county level compared, but still a lot of money.
Sorry, but with now no chance of paying the parking ticket. It's crazy.
Well, actually, the cost is a little higher than that. I checked the figures.
That's just true. He always comes up with a hard figure.
I just checked it before
but
we came here tonight.
But he's looking at the seniors. That's where he's going with this.
And at the state level, it's $37,267. There's no way that we spend $37,000 to educate a child in this, in this state. That's $102 a day. That's a lot of money. And when it comes down to parole issues and issues of that sort, helping individuals to get housing, home plans, many guys, especially those that we deal with, will spend a year or two in prison after they have parole.
Beyond.
So the state is saying, and the prison board is saying, and the jails themselves are saying, this person can go back into the community. They're prepared to go back into the community. Yet at $102 a day, we keep them there for another 2 or 3 years.
And why would that be?
They're homeless. They are being incarcerated because they're homeless.
When Scott Rare was the executive director of Berks Connections, he said that 17% of everybody getting out of Berks County Prison on a revolving door basis are considered homeless. Statewide, you know, you have people separated from their families for 5, 10, 15, 20, 25 years. Relationships are broken.
Sure.
They were put at some faraway location across the state. They're out. Who do they know? What connections do they have? If they're willing to work, but nobody will hire them, it's a major problem. We're asking for vagrancy and the consequences that spin off of that.
So just so I'm understanding, are you saying some people are not released from prison simply because they have nowhere to go when
they're
released?
They need to come up with a home plan, and if they cannot be approved for that home plan,
parole will require that.
Yeah, mm-hmm. They will not put them out on the street.
If you get a 5 to 10 year sentence, minimum maximum, once your 5 years is up, you are then the property of the parole board, a separate system from the Department of Corrections. They own you the next 5 years, and they can let you out when they want.
Okay.
And they're not going to let you out if they can't supervise you at places that are pre-planned to seem to be healthy and safe. And that's a good ideal, but to make it happen where the rubber hits the road sometimes is very complex.
And while you're in prison 5, 10 years, those family relationships break down.
I'm sure they do.
Your parents die. Your sisters and brothers move out of state. How are you going to get a parole plan in state when everybody you know and all of your relatives are out of state or dead or won't have anything to do with you anymore?
Right.
Then you're trapped in a situation in prison where you can't get access to information. So there's no way you can begin to search. Now, some people in prison are rather creative, and they can begin to find, using newspapers, they can begin to find real estate rental agents and such and write to them. But where are you going to get the money to pay that postage?
Well, furthermore, if you get somebody to say, oh, sure, I'll rent you a place, where's someone who's been in prison for 5 or 10 years going to come up with first month, last month, and security deposit?
Well, that's where New Person Center comes in.
Nice segue, Pat. So let's talk about that.
We're talking about the problem here, but here is the answer, you know, in a small way. You know, New Person Center, up until a year ago, we had 20 beds. Okay, so what Gordon was saying, if these guys have to sit in there because they have no place to go, you could say that those 20 beds would save the state $35,000 per bed. Well, guess what? That's
$37,000 per bed.
What did I say?
And 30 cents.
Remember, the new number. We have the new number.
Okay, let me try it again. 20 beds per year at
$37,000 a year.
Yeah, $37,000.
That's $2,000 more dollars.
I'm doing the easy math. Easy math here.
Okay. Modern math.
Okay, it's $700,000 on my math. Yeah. But over 10 years, that's $7 million. New Person Center has saved the state $7 million. Guess how much it costs the state for us to do that? Zero. It costs them, that's what the church can do when they step up to the plate. You know, that there is an answer here, and we're doing it. You know, and we've had about 400 people go through there in the last 10 years. So we're averaging probably 40.
400 people, wow.
Yeah, and last year we had 49, the year before we had 59, and I don't know how many we're going to have this year. But there is an answer to this, you know. And it's just fortunate. I mean, we do this for Christ. You know, I mean, our whole thing is Christ-based, you know. And we get to work with the lepers of society. You know, these are people that no one wants to deal with, but we can deal with them, and we're glad to deal with them. We look forward to dealing with them.
And it's very rewarding because we have a lot of alumni, you know, that just thank us. Within the last week, I had two different calls. Had a guy stopped in this afternoon who's an alumnus, just very grateful for what our program did with an outstretched arm for them 5 years ago, 10 years ago, whatever.
Yeah.
I just saw a picture today on Facebook of a guy that graduated from the Freedom Gate halfway houses like 25 years ago in Reading, and his wife did from our women's program. And now their daughters, it showed him their daughter, one daughter getting married yesterday.
Aww.
You know, it just looks so exciting to see them mm-hmm. living life now compared to where I first met them,
yeah.
you know, in cells, prison cells.
Right.
So it's rewarding when we have breakfast. Gordon here has is coordinator for alumni breakfast and different events. It's fun to see these dozens of people show up who now have jobs and are reuniting with families and making restoration. It's an exciting thing to see.
But it takes work to have yeah. that happen.
Yeah.
It takes work mm-hmm. to help the guys to get jobs. We have a case manager. You met Jim. Jim helps direct these guys in ways where they can find temporary employment and permanent employment. He helps them to locate some landlords that are mm-hmm. actually understanding of the situation.
Right.
And are willing to rent, and that always helps. But we got to keep working at it.
Mm-hmm.
And many of the men have gone to prison because they have personal problems and flaws. And we need to work to make sure that those personal problems and flaws do not manifest themselves again.
Right.
Maybe you could give a word about our banquet coming up on the 25th.
Well, we have this banquet on
September
the 25th. And Heidi Fuhrer, who was a counselor at SCI Waymart, which is up in the northern part of the state, will be coming down as our banquet speaker. And her topic is going to be the kinds of changes that men need to make in their lives, in their thinking, in their spirituality, in order to make a successful reintegration back into the community. So I think anyone that's interested in this topic will want to come out to that banquet. That's a Friday evening, the 25th. The meal itself is free, but we will be collecting a free will donation to help us support this program.
And where is that banquet, Gordon?
That's going to be at Grace Fellowship Church, which is on the west end of Shillington on the old Lancaster Pike.
Gotcha. And if someone would be interested in that, how could they
go to the website?
Ticket? Just newpersonministry.org.
Mm-hmm. They can go to the website. They can also make a telephone call directly to the office,
which is
610-777-2222.
That's easy. Okay. Very good. Thank you.
Can I just make a point?
Of course.
That there is answers here. And our New Person Center, we have probably 6-7 churches that really stand mm-hmm. by us. The Mennonite Church is huge, yeah. But what I'm trying to get to is that there is answers here, and prison is just not a good idea, but I don't know of a better idea. These guys need to be punished, but when they come out, there has to be someone there for them. There has to be someone there to pick them up so they don't go back in there. Our recidivism rate, Susan, at New Person Center is just about, if it's described as a new charge, it's just about nothing, because this program works. Now, if you call recidivism by how many go back on a parole violations, then it's a different story. We probably had 50, 60 go back on parole violations out of those 400 mm-hmm. over the years. And it's so easy to go back on a parole violation.
And that's a temporary going back. It could
yeah.
be a couple of months. It could be, I think the maximum we've had was about a year.
Could somebody just give an example of what a parole violation would be that would cause someone had been released from prison to be...
Sorry. Yeah.
Recent.
When someone comes out, they get a green sheet, right?
Yeah.
And on there, it was stipulations, what you can and can't do, okay? If you're a DUI, you can't go into a bar. If you have some kind of pornography thing, you can't go on the internet, And then you can't, if you're not allowed to be around kids, you can't be around kids, So.
Including your own children, and that gets to be a problem
yeah.
because these fathers do want to be around their children.
Yeah, I like to tell them when they come out, just consider yourself still in prison. You just get to walk around because they are very restrictive what they can do. And so someone gets drunk, they're going back to prison. They miss it. They get kicked out of a group. They're going back to prison. If the parole agent doesn't like something.
They get caught out overnight.
They're going back.
An hourly violation. They're supposed to be wherever it is they're living at 10 o'clock. If they aren't there...
You were
That's
talking about trends, Susan, from the top down in our nation. One of the positive things that I I'm happy to say is that in the last couple of years, the message from the top down to parole agents is give second chances wherever possible. Our prisons are too full. Do everything you can short of prison to give them sanctions. So now you have halfway back programs, which is what used to be called. So people will go to certain places that are designated in the state that are more like halfway houses run by the Department of Corrections. And then they're called community correction centers all across the state. And they're a lot easier to work with as far as paperwork and getting the people back out again. Because once you throw a person over those big walls into those 27 prisons, I know one guy that the judge here in the courthouse gave time served to, and it took almost a year and a half till parole got him out. Mm-hmm. He sat there at public expense for well over a year after the judge in the Berks County Court gave him time served.
Wow.
And you have a lot of those happening. That's expensive. That's expensive, expensive way of doing business.
We mentioned Senator Greenleaf here earlier. We were in a conference with him that we sponsored, and he was the first one to say, you know, he was the one responsible for putting these laws in. But now he said he realized how many repercussions were from these laws. You solve one problem, but you create five over here. So now he's trying to get these laws out. Well, guess what? You know, it's a whole lot easier to get them in than to get them out. You know, these laws, and it's a battle. You know, that these laws just aren't working, and we can't afford it. We just flat out can't afford it.
I would encourage people to go to the website for the Pennsylvania Prison Society, and it's prisonsociety.org. Prisonsociety.org. It started in Benjamin Franklin's living room 10 years after this country started, and it's been going for most of the years ever since. Very good organization in the state of Pennsylvania, one of the best in the nation, prisonsociety.org.
But doesn't that just say something if the Prison Society was started 10 years after the founding of this nation because there was a need for it?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Because people were abused in prison in Philadelphia. So Dr. Benjamin Rush, who's known as the head of psychology, wasn't my grandfather.
Yes, it was.
Unfortunately. but he and Benjamin Franklin and a clergyman, a bishop in Philadelphia, those three got together in Ben Franklin's living room and started the Prison Society.
They cared
about the people that were locked up. Mm-hmm. And we need to continue to care.
Is that where the prison visitor program comes from?
Yes, out of the Prison Society.
Yes. Yeah.
And then Prison Society, then there's Yoke Fellowship. Yeah, that's 700, I think around 700 volunteers across the state of Pennsylvania that go into more than half of all the state, federal, and local prisons in Pennsylvania. And here in Berks County, we have about 30 members, and we go in every Thursday for 2-hour Bible studies right into Berks County Prison.
Yeah. YokeFellowship.org. Y-O-K-E, fellowship, one word, yokefellowship.org.
The point being, there's a lot of ways, you know, for the church to step up to the plate to make, you know, a difference and really change some of these things. You know.
Mm-hmm. And other organizations as well.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Well, I guess I'm just talking because we're a new person center, we're a Christian halfway house, and so we really emphasize that.
And Pat's also on a board of a new group that's starting to start a women's program in Reading.
We're going to open a women's program, hopefully at St. Mary's, where Mary's Shelter is right now at 12th and Spruce. It's called Claire of Assisi House, and hopefully by January that's going to be up and running.
Oh, yeah. Excellent.
Very important.
Mm-hmm. And we're also working to try to get a program down in Lancaster County that would be also for men, which gives us the opportunity to reach out into York and Lancaster and Dauphin counties, Adams County, places like that. Mm-hmm. So right now, those people really have no place to go. As Pat often says, New Person Ministries is the only game in town in the state.
For the state.
As far as the type of faith-based program that we do. Mm-hmm. And you turn down about, 90-95% of all the inquiries on a weekly basis.
We get 60 letters a month, and we only take 5.
Wow.
So there's a huge need. We once had 28 beds, and now we're down to 14. And a lot of it has to do with neighbors or people not understanding what they don't need to fear as much as they do.
Yes. So. We are just about out of time. That went really, really fast. So I'd just like to say personally thank you for the good work that you all do at New Person Ministries. Mm-hmm. And thank you for being on the show. Mm-hmm. I am Susan Shelly McGovern, and we will say goodnight for tonight. Join us again next month for Centering on Peace.